Yeah. So that's what you said. So successful speculative execution, okay, you return a value, and otherwise you return bottom. So this can be simplified as follow. When you invoke an operation, what you do, you read the state, okay? Remember. And then you define a new state with the result, with your operation, okay? You have the local, you have the state of the object, and you apply your operation to the state of the object you obtain, okay? That's the new state is this one, and the result is R. And then, in a Boolean, you try to do store conditional. If you succeed, it means that between your LL and your SSC, no, the object was not written, okay? So in this case, done is true. And your operation has been applied. If you don't succeed, it means that there was concurrency, okay? You did LL, and between your LL and your SSC, someone else did store conditional, okay? So there was concurrency. So in this case, you return bottom, okay? So if done is true, you return the result. And if done is false, there was concurrency, you return bottom, okay? So algorithm is very, very simple. Now, this is trivial, but of course, you are scientists, don't, we are not satisfied when you have a simple solution. But no, we enjoy simple solution. That's very important, okay? We don't have to rebuild the world, rebuild the wheel each time we need it. And I hate when things are complicated, okay? But we have to have solutions that are general, okay? General, simple, and as general as possible. So of course, now abortability is not sufficient. We want to have k abortable object, not abortable object, but k abortable object. So what is the definition? So an operation is allowed to abort, to return bottom, only if it is concurrent, that was before, but now, concurrent with operation is issued by k distinct processes, okay? So you're executing an operation, and in addition is you, okay, concurrently with you, there are k processes that invoke also operation, okay? So in this case, you are allowed to abort, okay? But the k operations that entail your abort, okay, must not abort. Okay? So it means that if permanently there are at most k operations that execute concurrently, there is no abort at all. Okay? And if you abort, you need to have a good reason. The good reason is there was concurrency. The other one was preventing me, blah, 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 the enemy, blah, etc. No, no. Okay? But they need to win. They need to apply their operation, okay? So if you look at the definition, actually, N abortability is the same as bottom free with freedom. You don't have. So there is a very non-trivial algorithm, okay, that build a wet free compliant universal construction for K abortable object, okay, in the system read-write with LL and SSC. And it was proposed last year, okay, at the conference DISC, Symposium on Distributed Computing, okay, one of the two best conferences in the domain. Okay. To be honest, the algorithm is far from being simple. Okay. Now, let us continue. Let us continue. And so we have operation, so on memory location, so read-write, LL, SSC. So when you say read write, when I'm saying read write in a memory, okay, with read, you can access any memory location, okay? Whatever the content, you can read. Write, you can write, okay? And here, agreement object are defined. For example, so when you do a push with a classical meaning, it has a meaning only if you apply push to a stack. If you're doing push on a set, it has no meaning, okay? Differently, to write a memory location, it always works, okay? So I want to look at this kind of thing. So two type of questions. So the previous universal construction are based on hardware provided atomic operation. We have seen this one, okay? This operation, I'm repeating, can be applied to any memory location. So if you consider an allocation as an object, we can apply read to all the objects. But these memory locations actually are not objects, okay, in the classical sense. Okay. Memory location, I'm repeating, you can read and write it. A stack or insert in a set apply to a set, but insert operation has no meaning on a stack. Okay. So this is subtle, but it's different. So to fix the idea, more a precise question. We can design weight-free compliant universal construction with hardware operation. Question. Test and set and or fetch and add. Because these are operation provided by the hardware, okay? So if I tell you, you are read-write, you have test and set, okay? Is it possible to implement a weight-free universal construction? That's the problem. Okay? Or now, I replace test and set by fetch and add. Or I replace test and set by swap. By the swap, there are two kinds of swap hardware. One is taking a word of shared memory, a word of local memory, and is doing the exchange atomically, okay? There is another swap. It's taking two words of the shared memory, okay, and is exchanging them, okay? So all these operations are equivalent. Is it possible to design universal construction with the hardware operation or not, okay? So we want to know. That's our job, okay? So they are equal or not, okay? And second, another important question, is it possible to generalize the concept of universal construction to the coordinated construction of several objects? So that's subtle. So ici, to have only one object, I want two objects, okay? And I want a notion of universal construction that allows these objects to cooperate in some sense, okay? So that's more complicated. So to answer the question, I need to introduce the most famous object of distributed computing, okay, the fundamental object. If there is only one, it's this one. In sequential computing, the fundamental object is read-write on the Turing tape, okay? You need to be able to read and to write, okay? The other one, but as you know, an exercise in, you know, if I can ask you, for example, to implement mutual exclusion from read-write, that's possible, okay? Anything that can be done with read-write. Now, what is the basic object of distributed computing? It's the consensus object. So what is consensus? So I don't know if you are familiar or not. A little bit? Expert? Super expert? Okay. So I'm assuming all of you are expert, but for me to understand, I'm describing slowly. So, there is a single operation, okay? It is an object as a stack, okay, if you want. But, and I call it propose, the operation, okay? So, you can invoke this operation only once. So, it's a one-shot object. It's not a multi-shot object. Multi-shot, for example, stack, you can do push, pop, pop, push. You can invoke as many times as you want, okay? Here, only once. One shot. And you have an input parameter. So, you propose a value, actually. That's the idea. You propose a value, okay? When you invoke the operation. And consensus, and the operation will return you a value. Okay, you propose a value and you will obtain a value. So the meaning of consensus is defined by properties. Okay, and this, so a problem, I want to insist on that, a problem is defined by a set of properties, always. Safety, what is correct, and liveness, you have to terminate, okay. And this was introduced, this way to specify object, was introduced 20 years ago by Sam Tweg. And before that, it was a mess, because when you ask people to prove something is correct, okay, or to prove something, it was a mess because it was confusing the implementation with the specification. Okay. So here we have properties. So a decide value is the value that is returned to you, okay? So if you decide the value, it is one of the proposed value. So I translate, the problem is not trivial. We propose value and we decide bottom. Okay, whatever the value proposed. We always need to relate the output to the input, okay? That's validity. Agreement. No two processes decide distinct value. That's the key. That's a difficult property. Okay, so we propose value. If we don't crash, termination. If we don't crash, we decide. We have a result, okay? And we have the same value. We have the same result, okay? So this is a very basic problem. So why it is useful? It's because if we are unable to agree in a distributed system, we can solve only trivial problem, okay? For example, I want to duplicate an object, okay? You have a copy, I have a copy of the object, okay? So if the object is a counter, it's not so complicated, because even if your plus one is done before mine at your node, and in this order at your node, actually it's plus two, it's okay. The operations are commutative. But in a lot of cases, for a lot of objects, the operations are not commutative, okay? For example, if I'm doing push and pop, is not the same as pop followed by push, okay? So what is important, on each copy of the object, I have a copy, you have a copy, etc., we need to agree on the same order in which we'll apply the operation, okay? Okay, so if we apply the operation push and pop in the same order at each copy, the copy will not diverge, okay? It will be the same object, okay? So we need agreement. So that consensus was actually was proposed for the first time, very long time ago, in the 80s. Maybe some of you were not born yet at this time, I don't know. And by Lamport, in the context of synchronous system, okay? Synchronous. So we have synchrony assumption, and it's different. So if we have this object, how to solve the problem? To build a universal construction, so I want to present a consensus-based, weight-free-compliant universal construction. Okay, so each process is managing a local copy of the object. Okay, so you have the local copy of the object, the stack, for example, and an array SNI, where so I is the process where we are. Okay, and J, so SNI of J is the sequence number of the last operation of the object, okay, issued by PI. By PJ, okay? And locally apply to your state, okay? So you know that all the operations issued by PJ, okay, have been applied to the copy of the object up to this one, okay? And then, so I'm keeping the same notation and the same name as in the previous algorithm because they have the same meaning, okay? But to have the same meaning does not mean they are exactly the same variable, okay? They have the same name. So you have an array board. Okay, so in the memory, so board of J is, there is an operation and the sequence number, and that's the last operation issued by PJ, okay, and that's the associated sequence number, okay, as we did previously. And then, so in initial value, okay, and you have also in the shared memory an unbounded array of consensus objects, okay. By the way, so this is described with a proof. So in a book I presented at the beginning, so that's the structural, the software engineering part of the talk. Okay, so we have modules. So on processor PI, we have the local state of the object. You have a copy. Prop will be used, a proposal we'll see, and an array of sequence number. Each SNI of J is the sequence number of the operation by PJ that had been applied to your local copy, okay? So that's your local memory. And in the shared memory, you have the board where you post your next operation and the sequence number and an array of consensus object, okay? So now, when a process, so that's the universal construction, so when a process invokes an operation on the object, okay? So we are using a Boolean done, false, and then when it will become true, we will return the result. And in between, so you post, I want to execute this operation, okay, and the sequence number is this one. Okay? And this is written in the board, okay, everyone can read it, okay. So that's what is done locally. And in addition, you have a task in the background running forever, okay, and this stack, so while true do, you do that forever. So what you do is the following. you build a proposal that you will propose to the consensus object, to a consensus object, okay? And what is the proposal? So it resembles to what was done previously. For any other process, you look. Is the sequence number, okay, you read from the board for G, okay, is greater than the last sequence number, the sequence number of the last operation you know that has been, you have applied your, from G, PJ, that you apply to your copy, okay? So that, I'm repeating, this is the sequence number of the last operation by PJ, that have been applied to a local copy of the object. Okay? So if this is true, what does it mean? It means that your local copy, okay, this, the corresponding operation has not yet applied to your local copy. That's the meaning, okay? So what you do, you build a proposal, okay, and in this sequence, you add this pair, the operation by PJ that was posted. So this operation has this sequence number, and it was proposed by PJ, okay? So you add that. You see, from my point of view, with my local copy, this operation of PJ has not been applied, so I propose, okay, all of us, we execute it, okay? And I'm doing that for all the processes. So actually, prop may remain empty, or it can be a list with one operation, two operation, etc., okay? And then, if prop is not empty, okay, then I'm building a proposal, okay? You are building a proposal, so we need to agree. So we need to agree, and the idea is the following. So I propose my proposal, you propose your proposal, to the next consensus object, okay? So the next consensus object, you have consensus one, consensus two, so Ki was zero, so first is one, first, then is two, etc. And what do we do? So at the first consensus instance, I'm proposing what? I'm proposing, okay, the operation not yet executed on my copy, okay? And then I obtain a result. You remember the definition, and all of us, we obtain the same result. And what is the result? Is the list of operations to apply to our local copy, okay, proposed by one of us. And what we do, but then, to my local copy, so what I'm doing for on this list, okay, I'm taking the first element, mail element, okay, I'm applying the operation to my local state, it defines the new local state with a result, okay. And if I am the process that issues this operation, I equal J, okay, J is the process for which the operation was applied, okay, if I am this process, my operation has been executed, so done, the Boolean done is set to true, okay? That's all. And so I'm doing that for all of them. So why it works? Why? Question. Each of us has a local copy. Initially, we have the same value, okay? We have the same value of the object, the initial value of the object, okay? So why all of us, we will apply the operation in the same order to our local copies. So the concern number one defines the first list of the first sequence of operation applied to my copy. Okay? But the concern number one, the output is the same for all of us. You remember, you propose a value, a sequence, I propose a sequence, okay? But the consensus saying, all of us will output, will get the same value as a result, the same list. So I am applying the list provided by the consensus object, okay, to my copy. And you are applying the same list, okay? So of course, we are applying the same sequence of operation. And this is done for all the consensus instance, okay? So actually, this works, okay? So the proof is a little bit boring. So actually, all the local, the state of the object at each process, okay, is modified by the operation decided by consensus one, then by consensus two, then by consensus three, etc. And I'm repeating, here as a list of operations decided by consensus one is the same for all of us, okay? So we apply the same modification, P1, is applied to each state, this, the same sequence as P2, as P3, as P4, etc. So, this works. There is, so maybe I can skip this, the technical detail, except this, except this one. So I don't know if Rachid Gharaoui introduced that before or not. The notion of a consensus number. No, I don't think so. So what is a consensus number of an object? I'm repeating, why consensus is important? Because a consensus object allows us to agree. Okay? To agree, to apply, for example, in our case, the same sequence of operation on our local copy. Okay? So to prevent the copy to diverge. Now, let us consider an object of type T. Okay? For example, a set. The set type. Okay? The Q type. Okay? The consensus number of an object of type P, so it will be an integer, N, such that if I give you read-write register, okay, and any object of the type T as you want, an infinity if you want, okay, as many as you want, so you have, so the model is crash, asynchronous, read-write, plus object of type T now, okay? And N is the greatest number such that you can solve consensus in this system model, okay, for N processes. So if I have N processes, I can solve consensus, okay? Okay? So what are the great results? There is no such N. If it is infinite, okay, it means that you can solve consensus for any number of processes. Okay? So the question is the following. If I give you test and set, okay? So read-write, asynchronous, crash, plus test and set. You can solve consensus for how many processes? 1, 2, 3, 2.5, 4. No. Don't claim victory. So... So you agree? So I give you some object, for example, I can give you an object that is not 2, it's 3 or 4. Anyway, so second, if I give you a fetch and add, for how many processes can you solve consensus? In hardware, okay? Or I give you swap between local memory and shared memory, okay? Or the other swap, the swap exchanging atomically two words of the shared memory, okay? So the question is it to swap are equivalent or not? They have the same computational power, or one of them allow you to do more things than the other one, okay? So this was, the problem was posed and answered by Maurice Herli. That's the answer. So according to the book or to the paper, it's called consensus hierarchy or Herli hierarchy, okay? So it's a type, for me, when I discovered the paper by Maurice, he reminded me the Mendeleev table, okay? That's the Russian part of the talk. So the consensus number of read-write is 1. So you can solve consensus in a read-write system if you have only one process. But one process to agree with yourself is not so complicated, okay? Now, if I give you test and set. Test and set, actually, read-write, asynchronic crash, test and set, you can solve consensus for 2 processes, maximum, not 3. That's impossible. Okay? If I give you fetch and add, it's the same. If I give you swap between local memory and shared memory, okay, we change atomically. You can solve consensus for 2 processes, not 3. And now I'm skipping. Finally, if you take compare and swap, LLSC, etc., the consensus number is plus infinity. And for swap, for example, if you take the swap in which you exchange 2 words of the shared memory, okay, atomically, the consensus number is infinity. You can solve the consensus for any number of processes, okay? So now, question, if you want to buy a multicore, okay, and you have several machines, and one person is saying, oh, I have 1,028 processor, power of two, of course, and I have a special machine for which I can solve a consensus for this number of processor, exactly this number, okay? Puis there is another machine saying, my machine, she has, for example, compare and swap. Which machine do you buy? The first one or the second one? The second one, because the second one, you can solve consensus for any number of processes, okay? On the other one, of course, if the constant number of the machine is 128, it means that you can solve consensus for 128 nodes, okay? Processor, okay? So you design all your code with this machine, okay? With this operation, okay? But then when we change, then you buy a machine with 2048, okay, it doesn't work. You need to rewrite your software, okay? If you are using directly compare and swap, it's much easier, of course. Now, so we have the following. Consensus objects are universal in the sense that they allow to actually implement any object defined by a sequential specification, okay? In crash asynchronous read-write, okay? So you are adding the consensus object to this model, okay? So that's important. Now, there is something that is interesting is there are universal constructions that have been proposed. Oh, sorry. So that's important. So have you seen consensus is not a hardware operation, okay? It's an object as a stack. We do propose, okay? And then we are able to solve the problem, okay? We have a result. All of us will have the same output, okay? And it is a value that has been proposed by one of us, okay? This can be implemented, for example, with compare and swap. But compare and swap is a machine operation, okay? It's provided by the machine, okay? So here I want to merge the two things. And actually, what can be done, the question, what can be done when several hardware operations, you allow them to access the same memory location? Up to now, okay, remember, I said, we have some object, the board, okay, you remember state, accessed by distinct operation. Here, we are using, okay, the same memory location. So this was presented last year as the other, as a conference POTC, Principle of Distributed Computing, and POTC on one side, and the conference DISC on the other side, as the two top conference, okay, on the domain. The result proposed by Hélène, Faith Hélène, Gitas Gelashvili, Nir Shavit, and Luzu, okay, in this paper. So, I give you, I have to be more precise. So, system and example, illustration. Async crash, asynchronous read-write, and processes, and I give you, in the machine, I tell you, you have test and set, okay, and you have fetch and add, too. So I define this operation, in hardware. So test and set, so my definition is the variant of the real definition. Test and set returns the value in the memory location, okay, and sets it to 1 if the value was 0, okay? So, if the value was 0, you set it to 1, okay, and you obtain the value that you obtain 0. If it is 1, you set it to 1 and you return 1, it means. Fetch and add, 2. So it returns the value in the memory location, okay, and it increases it by 2. Okay. That's the two operations, and this. So this one exists in hardware, and this one can be built easily, okay. So that's only an exercise, okay? So if you take test and set, so if I'm taking this system, this model, you can solve consensus for two processes, not three, okay? if I'm taking this system, you can solve consensus for two processes and not three. Because the consensus number of test and set is two, and the consensus number of fetch and add, two, is two. Okay? So question, which is the consensus number, or the power, computability power, of a system in which you have both test and set, and fetch and add two. Okay? They need glass because they say that. Yes. So actually, the answer is infinity. And that's the solution. That's the algorithm. And one exercise I gave to Piotr is modifying that. So what is the idea? Okay, you have a single memory location X, okay, and the initial value is zero. Okay. And now that's the algorithm building solving consensus. Okay, so you propose a value. So I'm interested in the binary consensus. Binary consensus, we propose zero or one. Okay, and we need to agree on the same value. Okay, it means that if all of us we propose one, only one can be decided. Similarly for zero, and if some of us propose one, the other one propose zero, there is the consensus has to extract to select one number, okay, zero or one. It has to solve non-determinism, and that's the difficult part. So if the operation is zero, the value you propose is zero, what you do is the following: you do fetch and add on the object, okay, and if the object is odd, you return one. If it is even, you return zero. Now, if the value is zero, you do a test and set. Okay? And according to the value you obtain, if it is odd, or if it is the initial value, then you return one, otherwise you return zero. So actually, mechanically it's not difficult, but it's difficult to understand how it works, why it is correct. Okay? It's very short, this algorithm, building consensus from these two operations. So first, I wrote here some things that was important. Fetch and add two preserve parity. When you do a fetch and add, you add two. So if the value was even, it remained even. If the value was odd, it remained odd, okay? It doesn't change the parity, okay? So what happened? So, of course, we need a proof, but so I will reason only with a few examples, okay? So first, suppose you propose zero, and when you propose zero, you propose zero, okay? Maybe I'm proposing zero, or I am proposing one, okay? If I propose zero, it's the same as you, so there is no conflict on the value. Okay, if I propose one, what does happen? So you will execute fetch and add, I will execute test and set. The initial value is zero, okay? And you see that the fate of the value is decided by the first operation applied to X. Okay, so the decision actually is sealed by the first atomic operation, this one or this one. If the first operation on X is this one, what does happen? Okay, so you remember the definition. Fetch and add two, it returns the value of the object and add two. So it means that if it is this one, it returns zero, you remember, and it adds two. Okay? So what is the result? So we are assuming that zero is odd, of course. So is odd, sorry. That's correct. So if the first operation is this one, okay, what is done? You return zero, and now in X there is two, in big X, okay? So X is not odd, okay? So you return zero. Okay? Now you did, if another, sorry, and you propose one, okay? What does happen? But this fetch and add has been executed before this one. Okay? There are two cases. This one first and this one, or this one first and this one. Okay? So here, what is the value you obtain here? X is in the set, there is 2 now, okay? So you obtain the value 2, okay? So X is odd? No. X is 0? No. You return 0, okay? So actually, if you look all the cases, there are 4 cases, okay? There is no ambiguity. All of us will decide the same value. Now, there is something that is it possible? What is your intuition? I give you a solution to binary consensus. I give you for free an algorithm solving consensus or when the values that are proposed are 0 or 1. Okay? And on top of it, I want to solve consensus, what is called multi-valued consensus, to solve consensus when the value we propose are arbitrary. Okay? So that's possible. Okay? And so it means as soon as we have consensus for bits, we can solve consensus for any other, for multi-valued consensus. Okay? There are plenty, plenty. I know at least 5 or 6 algorithms doing that. Okay? So, time is passing. So maybe I want just to give you an idea of something else. So suppose that we don't have one object, state machine, we have k objects. So, with consensus, we are able, each of us, to have a copy of the object, okay, and all these copies progress in the same way. They don't diverge, okay? Why? Because we are able to apply the same sequence of operation, okay, to our copies, okay? Now, I want something more. I want to design a weight-free compliant universal construction, so a general algorithm, in which at least one object progress forever. You have k object, not only one, but k. And at least one object can progress forever, okay? Or more complicated, I want not one, but l object progress forever. So the first problem was posed and answered by Eli Gavny and Rachid Gharaoui, okay, generally in universality. And the second one was solved by my student Julien Steiner, Gadi Dobenfeld from Israel, and myself, okay? And it appeared in a journal last year. The conference version was before. So what is the idea? The idea, as we want, we have not only one object, but k object, okay? So the idea, the first idea, common in the two papers, two solutions, is to replace, so to have k object in which at least one progress, okay, is weaker than to have a single object that progresses forever. Why? It's because if I consider the k object as a single object, okay, I can do that with consensus. Okay, so I have k object and my requirement only one of them progresses forever. Okay, there's the operation applied to it forever. It will be possible. So this actually consists in considering not consensus, but K-set agreement, also called K-set consensus. So it's similar to consensus, so this was proposed by Soma Chaudhuri, as you can see, a long time ago, in 1993. Okay. It consists in 6 consensus, so we propose value, and we decide value, and the agreement is weaker, is at most K different values are decided. So maybe k equals 3, for example, okay. Maybe some of you decide a value v1, other one decide a value v2, other people decide a value v3, okay, and no more. Okay. So if you consider k equal 1, you have consensus, okay. So it's a stronger problem, okay. So this, we can decide distinct value, okay, and up to k, no more than k. Of course, the problem with k equal n is trivial. I decide my value. Okay, of course, it's trivial. So this problem generated a lot of literature. Okay, so if you have that, you can solve the first problem. Okay, so maybe I don't want to. I'm skipping the detail. I'm skipping because after it's technical. And I don't know you, but in my case, I'm a little bit child. So I must confess that I am a human being. I'm not yet a machine, okay? So to conclude, the case for distributed universal construction actually is at the heart of distributed computing, okay? It's the same as sequential computing. When you are interested in theory, you want to have the universal solution, okay? It doesn't mean that you can apply it every day, okay? But if you know something that is universal, okay, you know the most difficult, okay, and so you are obliged a priori, this allows you to solve simpler problems, okay? So to understand distributed computability is concerned by mastering uncertainty, okay? Definitely. And the uncertainty is created by what is called on the generic name environment, okay? So environment, you have the asynchrony. For example, in synchronous system, consensus can be solved, okay? Very easily. You don't need to. Now, failure, okay? And concurrency. And this quest is far from being finished, okay? Because you have still, for example, the first universal construction was proposed in 93, okay? But the simplest I presented, the first one I presented, okay, is a few years ago, was designed a few years ago, okay? As it's much simpler, okay? So it's not finished, okay? So I will stop here.